If you followed me on social media, especially Twitter, for any extended length of time, you've probably seen me complain about comparison videos of render times between Adobe Premiere Pro and Final Cut Pro 10, or other NLEs. Part of this frustration comes from the fact that most people involved really have no need to focus on render times in the first place, and that I wholly believe that the overall workflow is more important. It's nice if an app can render a video way quicker than my rig, but if I have to edit on a tiny little MacBook to make that happen, my hand and neck strain say no. But part of the frustration also comes from the fact that it seems that none of these people take into account any of the optimization possibilities within Premiere Pro. Yeah, sure, if you want the easiest out-of-box experience with performance, FCPX on a MacBook Pro is the way to go. That rhymed. But if you, as a video professional who spends hours upon hours in the same video editing software, want to develop and polish your own production workflow, especially without making the drastic shift over to Apple's closed-door platform, the whole conversation is just kind of embarrassing. So in this video, I'd like to do my part to stop just complaining and hopefully provide some valuable information based on the optimizations that have made a world of difference for my workflow in Premiere. I'm not an expert, just a guy who uses Premiere Pro daily for his work, and has been for going on 5 years now. This kind of thing is what I dig into whenever I experience problems with my software, and there's lots of little things I've done that I'll try to recall here. This video is brought to you by TubeBuddy, the best tool you can get to manage your YouTube channel, update videos in bulk, syndicate to social media, and back up your metadata and more, all with this simple browser extension. Head on over to eposvox.com/TubeBuddy to download it for free and learn more. TubeBuddy! Download for free! Learn more! I love it! I'm EposVox, here to make tech easier and more fun, and today we're taking a look at some of the issues and optimizations related to Premiere Pro performance. Specifically, I will be covering this from a Windows perspective, since that's what I use and I don't own a modern Mac. But many or all of these settings will apply to some varying degree on a Mac as well. GPU. First and foremost, let's cover the basic hardware choice and optimization settings. Premiere Pro editing relies most heavily on a bunch of CPU cores and a lot of RAM. The more you can get in those departments, the better. CUDA acceleration via a modern high-end NVIDIA graphics card can improve your experience and performance, but there is a lot of misinformation going around in that department. Only some effects truly utilize the GPU for actual rendering. Certain color effects and in-video effects, as well as frame size scaling, either upscaling or downscaling, can utilize the GPU to be a little bit faster while the CPU handles other things. But when it comes to the actual encoding and decoding of your video footage, no video codecs that you're going to use in any remotely normal workflow, professional or amateur, will be GPU accelerated. So the primary part of your rendering process will not be made faster by a GPU. Only specific effects will use it. That doesn't mean that you can't benefit from having the GPU in your system, however. While codecs are not GPU accelerated, using the Mercury Playback Engine and CUDA and a graphics card, certain codecs can sort of utilize the GPU. Codecs including Apple's ProRes, Avid's DNX series, DNX HD, DNX XQ, DNX HR, and GoPro Cineform are really, really fast, which we'll touch on in a minute. But with these codecs specifically, Premiere can use CUDA to offload the decoding of them within your video timeline to your GPU, so that your CPU can handle other things. And of course, I'm smack dab in the middle of the video and a lawnmower starts up outside. Your NLE can't fix that one. This doesn't technically count as GPU acceleration, but it can speed up your editing timeline performance drastically. Data as to whether or not actual renders are sped up via the GPU with these codecs is extremely inconsistent and hit or miss, even in my own testing. So I will support Adobe's statement that there is no true GPU acceleration happening here with the actual decoding and encoding, but you might see little benefits if you have a GPU in your system anyway, at least a good one. A slow one will still bottleneck you. If you're choosing hardware and you had to choose between a more powerful processor with no graphics card or a low-end one, and a low-end processor with a beefy graphics card, I'd say go for the more powerful processor and just use CPU only in Premiere if your graphics card is a bottleneck. RAM usage. Basically, I'll be alternating between complicated and simple tips to keep this easy to digest. So the next tip, if you were unaware, Premiere and any Adobe CC app, since they all share the same pool of memory, lets you adjust how much of your system's RAM it can use. By default, it's set to around 70 or 75% of your total system memory when you first open the suite on that computer, but you can increase it. This can be helpful if you do a lot of intensive timeline editing with many layers, nested sequences, multiple Photoshop and After Effects dynamically linked files, and so on. The Adobe suite will eat up any RAM you give it, and some third-party programs actually use beyond your set limit. This doesn't mean you should give it all of your system memory, though. If you do a lot of multitasking with non-Adobe apps while editing, they need RAM too. There have been plenty of times when I have Windows popped up saying I've run out of system memory and asks me to close Premiere. Thanks, Windows. Thankfully, I can just say no, but I feel quite limited by my mere 32 gigabytes of RAM at the moment, which is a lot for a lot of people. Media cache and scratch. One of the most overlooked yet important aspects of Premiere's functionality lies in the junk files it creates. Premiere relies heavily on its media cache files to do what it wants. The revolutionary advantage of Premiere over older NLEs back in the day was that you didn't need to work with rigid formats. You can throw in literally anything on the timeline and Premiere will make it work, up to a certain extent. But it does so by generating audio peak files, conformed file previews, and other cached data. This is also a bad thing, as those files go to your boot drive by default and do not clear themselves out automatically. So if you found your fast but small boot SSD to fill up very quickly after editing a few projects in Premiere, that's likely why. This sounds like an annoyance, but this is actually a huge point of potential optimization to speed up your renders and the responsiveness of your project. Especially if your main footage storage is on a network drive. And there's actually two different points of optimization for this setting. Firstly, if you go to Edit, Preferences, Media Cache, you can clear out all of the junk files and move the actual media cache storage location to somewhere else. Now you might think to move this to a big spinning hard drive or something so you can save on space, but that will technically slow things down. Premiere operates best when this is running from a local SSD. And even more so from an NVMe SSD with those unbelievably amazing random read speeds. So if you truly want to maximize optimization for editing and rendering in Premiere, then you will get a lot of performance gains by investing in a pair of SATA SSDs or a decent PCIe NVMe SSD to run your cache and scratch disk on. This will improve timeline responsiveness and speed up renders, especially on network footage. The scratch disk is actually changed on a per project basis. When you make a new project in modern versions of Premiere Pro, you have a tab for scratch disks. Now with big, complex projects and workflows, especially on spinning disks, you may have used individual disks for each category in the past. But a single SSD for all of these will more than suffice. You have to manually change each location, and sometimes it won't remember this for the next project, but it's really worth doing. The default locations for these files are in the same folders as your project files. This is the biggest slowdown of network storage-based projects, as it has to load all of the previews and such over the network, whereas storing them on a super-fast local drive provides huge performance gains. Unless you're juggling dozens of projects at once and can't clear out the cache or scratch disks, even just a single 120GB or 250GB NVMe SSD will suffice to handle both of these cache settings and speed up your production. Just keep in mind that if you work on projects from multiple locations, then you'd need to regenerate all the previews and such each on each machine, and it might not work out the same way. If I render on my render server, it has to regenerate all those previews on the server. Preview! Now for another basic one that some editors don't always consider, your playback preview resolution. During normal editing, you don't really need to preview your timeline at 100% quality the whole time. It's important during color grading and checking detailed work, but the rest of the time, it's generally a good idea to drop your preview to 1/2 or 1/4 so that the playback frame rate is stable, especially if you're working with heavy H.264 footage or another unwieldy codec. You can set in the options to show 100% quality when paused, so you still get nice still previews, and then have a much better timeline performance with lower qualities while actually editing. Saves a lot of hassle.
Overlay clips.
Similarly with that, when working in a timeline with a lot of overlay clips, lower thirds, adjustment layers, and so on, simply turn off those tracks when they're not in use while editing. This will, naturally, speed up your timeline performance tremendously. Just remember to turn them back on and check timings before rendering. But this is an all too forgotten step. No reason to keep rendering things in real time once you've settled on where they go.
Adjustment layers.
Speaking of which, use adjustment layers in the first place. If you're adding color grading, color effects, and so on, apply them to adjustment layers over top the clips in the same place. If the effects are applied directly to the clips, then you can't turn them off as easily while editing, and it's just generally considered to be less than ideal practice. Using them and color coding them can help you keep track of things a lot better in your projects.
You can also click the plus button below your video player, which adds a global FX mute button to your player controls, which globally mutes any effects applied to clips. The problem is that this affects all effects, so motion, scaling, and everything, not just color grading or something you might apply to an adjustment layer. So it is an option, but not always the best choice for what you're doing, and it doesn't automatically do it while you're playing back. You have to pause your playback and then hit the button and then resume playback.
Sequence sizing. If you are someone who regularly uses video footage of varying sizes and frame rates, you can improve your timeline performance by holding out on scaling them until the last possible moment. Use nested sequences to edit your footage in their native resolution, and then bring in the nested sequence and scale to fit your main timeline closer to the end. It's much, much easier to edit footage at its native resolution and frame rate, and then just let your computer power through the rendering of it later. If you don't use many nested sequences in the first place, they can become your new best friend if you learn to use them.
Color labels.
This is more of a workflow optimization tip than a performance one, but utilizing Premiere's color label system can really help you keep track of a messy timeline more easily. In the preferences, you can select specific colors for your 8 labels, though annoyingly they only give us the ability to have 8 color labels at once. I really hope they let us use more soon. And you can assign defaults for your labels. Still images are one color, video files are another, dynamic links are another, and so on. But then you can use any extra ones for your own assignment, i.e. make a row green, make B row blue, standard graphics package red, additional graphics pink, and so on. Creating your own color system and adhering to it regularly can help a lot when it comes to projects that you return to frequently or just staying organized in general.
Codecs and proxies.
All right, let's talk about the messy subject of video codecs. This is super technical and requires just some judgment calls about what is important to you. And again, I'm no expert. I'm learning as I go, but I've wanted to share what I've learned thus far so you can use it to your advantage. Most things record in H.264 or some variant of it these days. Most cameras, camcorders, computer recording programs, capture cards, webcams, and smartphones. H.264 quickly dominated as the easiest codec for devices to handle and shove whatever quality into a small file size. The codec is quick to encode, but very, very slow to decode, which is why timeline performance and export performance from H.264 is horrible. It's not that your computer can't handle editing whatever resolution or frame rate you're attempting to use, but H.264 is just obnoxious to work with. This creates a common disconnect between users and their hardware specs when it comes to editing. The good, or maybe bad news, is that there are other options. 3 other codecs perform remarkably better on the timeline, but take up nearly 10 times the space. Apple's ProRes, Avid's DNX codecs, and GoPro Cineform all perform amazingly on the timeline. Scrubbing quickly or with 100% playback quality is never an issue with these video codecs on most machines. They're super lightweight when it comes to decoding them. The trade-off, however, is that they're basically uncompressed video formats. So Lightweight in performance means the opposite in storage space. This is why many productions utilize proxy files. You could do this manually like I did in 2016, set up an ingest station to automatically take all of your footage and transcode it to Cineform and then spit it back out for you to edit those files, but it's an organizational mess and a storage headache. Instead, you can actually use Premiere to automatically generate proxy files for your projects. This is in your project settings when you first start a project and can be accessed via File, Project Settings, Ingest Settings. You can use Adobe Media Encoder to set up a proxy preset using Cineform or DNX on Windows or ProRes on Mac to use in Premiere. I recommend setting to a lower resolution such as 720p for speed and also making and adding a lower opacity watermark for this as well. That way you can quickly see when you're using the proxies versus the source files in Premiere. Then use this preset in your project settings. Set the proxy file location to an easily wipeable folder, a local SSD perhaps, cough cough, and import your footage. Premiere will then automatically generate proxies in the background during inactive periods while you're editing. Much like the background rendering that Final Cut Pro does. You have a toggle to switch between proxies and source files in the Premiere Project Monitor, so you can use the full quality files for grading and the like. Make sure you switch back to the source files before rendering and you're good to go. Your projects will be much smoother to edit using these proxy files, and then you can delete them once you're completely done with the project. This is important for really bulky files like the big 10-bit 4K 60 files generated by the Panasonic GH5. Most people aren't able to edit those in H.264 form, but generate proxy files, good to go. One of the benefits I'm looking forward to about using my Atomos Ninja Inferno that I recently purchased was that it records natively to ProRes or DNX HR, so I have speedy edits straight out of the box. I'll be using this for some desktop recording as well, which is great, as the lossless NVENC recordings that I usually use are a nightmare to edit with. As I mentioned before, CUDA acceleration in Premiere will actually offload some of the decoding of Cineform, ProRes, and DNX to your GPU, allowing you to enjoy the benefit of a smoother timeline performance without eating up as much CPU resources. So that's really neat too.
Photoshop.
Lastly is just a note on Photoshop files. While the direct integration between Premiere and Photoshop is wonderful and a lifesaver if you ever catch a mistake and need to edit your Photoshop files on the fly, really complex and multi-layered Photoshop files can slow down your timeline and render performance. So if you have some final production graphics, it may be worth it to export them as flattened PNGs to save on performance if you're sure you won't be updating them. And even if you do change them, you can simply replace the files in your project media folder later. Well, there you have it, my 10 tips for optimizing Premiere Pro to get the most performance gains and a smoother workflow. I had no idea this video would wind up being so big, but I really feel like there's some good information in here that you don't see grouped together very often. Premiere Pro is not a basic YouTuber's tool. It is a professional software that's designed to be learned from the inside out and tweaked and customized to your specific workflow. When comparing different NLEs, it's important to consider what optimizations are available to you and where you might actually need to learn for your own software. Hopefully, I've opened this conversation up a bit beyond the, look, FCPX renders faster on this tiny MacBook, or at least provided some useful information. Was this guide helpful? Smash the like button and get subscribed if so. Have additional optimization tips that I should include or consider? Leave them in the comments below. Otherwise, I'm EposVox, and I will see you next time. Woo!
This video is sponsored by viewers like you. Our videos would not be possible without the generosity of those of you who contribute to one of our fan funding options, be it DonorBox, Twitch subscriptions, direct contributions via PayPal, or Patreon. To join our inner circle and get behind-the-scenes looks at videos, go to eposvox.com/support to learn more, and join us on Discord at eposvox.com/discord. Thanks!